And how? His anti-Semitism is just a manipulation by the ruling class so that they are free to not attack by the workers, free to exploit them, and so on and so on. And this is even up to a point, as far as I was able to establish, empirically true. While many communists joined Nazis in Germany in the late 20s and 1930s, and so on, the opposite process is very rare. So you see my point, although it may seem to be much easier to say to an anti-Semitic worker, but can't you see, you are duped, the real enemy is elsewhere, this process is de facto a very difficult one. So again, today's hegemonic ideological scene is split between two modes of fetishism, cynical and fundamentalist. While the fundamentalist directly ignores or at least mistrusts argumentation, blindly clinging to his fetish, the cynic pretends to accept argumentation but ignores its symbolic efficiency. In other words, while the fundamentalist not so much believes as directly knows the truth embodied in his fetish, the cynic practices the logic of disavowal. Je sais bien, mais quand même. I know very well, but. With regard to today's situation of ideological struggle, this means that one should at least view with profound suspicion those leftists who argue that the so-called, I will tell you immediately the other side of the story, that the so-called Muslim fundamentalist populist movements are basically ours, emancipatory anti-imperialist movements, and that the fact that they sometimes formulate their program in, if not anti-Semitic, at least anti-European Enlightenment, anti-universalist terms, is just a confusion that results from their being caught in the immediacy of their struggle. Like when they say, that's how some French Arab were telling me, you should always bear in mind that when they attack the Jews, what they really mean is just that they are against Zionist colonialism. I think that we should resist this logic, because once we accept it, we make the first step on the path at the end of which is the quite logical conclusion that since Hitler also really meant capitalists when he spoke of Jews, he should be ultimately our ally in the global anti-imperialist struggle with the Anglo-American Empire as the principal enemy. And this line of reasoning is not just a funny rhetorical exercise. Do you know that the Nazis effectively did promote anti-colonialist struggle in Arab country, in India, and so on and so on? So what makes the unique figure of Jacques Vergès, the French lawyer, a universal phenomenon is that I claim he embodies precisely this option of solidarity between fascism and anti-colonialism. But as I already said, this is one side of the story, this unconditional rejection of any anti-Semitism. The other side of the story, which is crucial, I'll give you one version of it. You remember how when in the spring of this year, Taliban took over the Swat Valley in the north of Pakistan, the usual reports were, oh my God, fundamentalists won, crazy, and so on and so on. Of all the media that I know, only, you see how sometimes truth emerges where you wouldn't expect it, only one short article in New York Times, which just then disappeared, nobody, as far as I know, reacted to it, hinted at the other dimension. It made it clear how, I quote New York Times, how a class revolt that exploits profound fissures between a small group of wealthy landlords and their landless tenants is what was going on there. Now I quote, not the Palestinian terrorist propaganda, I quote New York Times, quote, in Swat Valley, accounts for those who have fled from Taliban make clear that the Taliban seized control by pushing out about 4 dozen landlords who held the most power. To do so, the militants organized peasants into armed gangs that become their shock troops. The Taliban's ability to exploit class divisions adds a new dimension to the insurgency, and it's raising alarm about the risks to Pakistan, which remains largely feudal. And then they quote one advisor to Obama who said, "The people of Pakistan are psychologically ready for a revolution. Sunni militancy is taking advantage of deep class divisions that have long festered in Pakistan. The militants, for their part, are promising more than just prescriptions on music and schooling. They are promising justice." End of quote. Now, you notice the ideological bias of this New York Times article. It says that it refers to Taliban's ability to exploit class divisions, as if Taliban's true agenda is elsewhere, in religious fundamentalism, and they are only taking advantage of the plight of the poor, landless, farmless. To this, one should simply add two things. First, such a distinction between the true agenda and instrumental manipulation is externally imposed onto Taliban, as if the poor landless farmers themselves do not experience their plight already in what we refer to as fundamentalist religious terms. Second, if by taking advantage of the farmers' suffering, the Taliban are raising alarm about the risks to Pakistan, which remains largely feudal, what prevents liberal Democrats in Pakistan, as well as the United States, to simply take advantage of this same plight and try to help the landless farmer? The sad implication of the fact that this obvious question is not raised in the New York Times article is that the feudal forces in Pakistan are considered the natural ally of liberal democracy. What phenomena like Taliban demonstrate is that Walter Benjamin's old thesis, "Every rise of fascism bears witness to a failed revolution," not only still holds today, but is perhaps more pertinent than ever. Liberals like to point out similarities between left and right-wing extremisms. Hitler's terror camps imitated Bolshevik terror. The Leninist Party is today alive in Al-Qaeda. Yes, but I agree. But what does all this mean? It can also be read as an indication of how fascism, if we accept, that's another question, that this Muslim fundamentalism is fascism. I will immediately approach this problem. That how fascism literally replaces, take the place of the leftist revolution. Its rise is the left's failure, but simultaneously a proof that there was a revolutionary potential, dissatisfaction which the left was not able to mobilize. And thus, again, the same not hold for today's so-called, by some people, I will immediately return to it, Islamofascism. Is the rise of radical Islamism not strictly correlative to the disappearance of the secular left in Muslim countries? Today, when Afghanistan is portrayed as the utmost Islamic fundamentalist country, who still remembers that 30 years ago it was a country with a strong secular tradition up to a powerful communist party which took power there independently of Soviet Union? Soviet Union intervenes only later when the communist power was crumbling. Again, where did this secular radical tradition disappear? It transformed itself, of course, into so-called Islamic fundamentalism. The same goes for United States. I hope you read the wonderful popular, it's not big theory, book by Thomas Frank called What Happened in Kansas. Kansas is the US homegrown version of Afghanistan. The very state which till 1970s was the bedrock of radical leftist populism. They were always in the first place to fight racism and so on, even politically. No, my God, the greatest figure of the struggle against slavery, John Brown, is from Kansas and so on, is today the bedrock of Christian fundamentalism. Again, does this not confirm Benjamin's thesis that every fascism is an index of a failed revolution? Furthermore, is the term Islamofascism, proposed among others by Francis Fukuyama and the above-mentioned friend of mine, Bernard-Henri Lévy, justified?